Jesus said, can you hear me? Jesus said the last days would be similar to the days of Noah. Now, my message is not about that, but I want to extract something from that. In the days of Noah, something unprecedented happened. It had never rained before. The Bible says water came up from the ground. Firmament was, scientists believe that the firmament was an ice shield several miles above us. You know what? And that the earth was covered with an ice, a layer of ice, maybe, who knows how thick, maybe half a mile thick of ice. You know, if you go up so many thousand feet, it's 50 degrees below zero. Whenever I fly to other nations, it's always, you look on the temperature, it's 55 below outside. So the earth was, before the flood, the whole earth was like a paradise. The scientists believe that with that ice covering around the earth, it filtered out all the ultraviolet rays. And then it caused the whole earth to be tropical. The whole earth would have looked like Hawaii because of that. And because of all the green plants, then oxygen would have been up about 25% from what it is now. And that the whole earth would just be completely different. Paradise. That's why they believe they find like mastodons up near the North Pole that have tropical vegetation in their intestines. How that happened? Well, the earth used to be different. There was an ice covering around the earth. So the whole earth was like a greenhouse, just perfect weather all around the whole globe. And God made everything good, didn't he? And then the fall came and the firmament was broken up. And so what was up there began to melt. However God did it, and he caused it to rain all over the earth, a great flood. We know that something's going to be reversed, because when we go to the book of Revelation, when John sees the new world that God's going to remake this earth, he said there's no oceans. But don't worry, we're still going to have beautiful bodies of water. You ever go to the Great Lakes? They're so big they look like oceans. There's no oceans. Why would that be? Because the water will go back up and go back around the globe and make the whole earth a beautiful paradise. Now, something unprecedented happened. Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so will it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. God told Noah to prepare by faith for something that had never happened before. There was no precedent. In the previous 900 years, 1,000, whatever long it had been, from Adam till Noah, it had never rained. God said, water's going to start pouring out of the sky. Noah believed it. God said, prepare. Noah believed. Noah obeyed. We're now living in the last days. He said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. I'm going to tell you, there's some unprecedented things coming on the earth that have never happened before. And God's preparing his church, the church that's listening. And that means we have to prepare for something that we have never seen in our life. We have to prepare for something we've never heard about existing in church history. And one of the things, well, we have read about it. There's been glimpses of it. There's been outbreaks here and there, but not sustained. And that is the habitation of God in his manifested glory on the earth in the midst of a Christian community. That is the gospel. And we have to break out of the traditional mindset of hundreds of years of church where that hasn't been the case. We have to break out of that. We have to let the Word of God be our standard. Let the entrance of the Word bring light, and in His light we see light. So that's what we're talking about, pursuing the habitation of the Lord. And when God opens our eyes to realize this is real, it's in the Word. Once your eyes are open and you go back and read through the New Testament, you'll see it everywhere. It's all there. Read 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and 7. There's the habitation of the Lord. Read Ephesians chapter 2. There's the habitation where God is building His people together into a dwelling place where He fills those people. Now, this is Scripture. Ephesians 3, Paul prays that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. That's something that's the Bible. That's our inheritance by the blood of Jesus. That is our inheritance. We can have that if we believe, if we do what He says. It's our inheritance. God wants that on the earth more than we do. Right now, God would want to be in here in His manifest glory. Right now, He wants it more than anybody in here wants it. You say, then why doesn't it happen? Because He doesn't want us all to die. He doesn't want to have to judge all of us. So He knocks on the door. He woos. He calls us. And He calls us to come up higher, to draw near to Him. Because if we draw near to Him, He draws near to us. That's what the prophetic word was. That was another knock on the door. That was the Lord saying, "Can I come in?" When the Lord knocks on the door, before you open it, you pick the laundry up off the floor. You straighten up the kitchen if you know He's coming. That's why the Lord says, "Hey," that's what the word is. I'm knocking on the door. I want to come. And God wants to come in fullness, not just so we can have a great Sunday morning experience. So that He can, it's not about us having a better time. So that we would be vessels of the manifested, healing, saving, delivering, redeeming presence of God so the whole city can be touched. And if we care about God, and if we care about His will, if we care about what He cares about, He cares about the city. If we care about it, we'll give ourselves to be His habitation. See, that was Jonah's problem. He didn't care about the people God was sending him to. God sent him to the Ninevites. The Ninevites were wicked people. They were wicked. And it was hurtful to Jonah. Jonah had personal issue with it. He was hurt by their wickedness. When God said, go, tell them in 40 days they're going to be overthrown. Now, God didn't tell Jonah, tell them, and if they repent, I won't do it. God didn't tell him that. He just said, in 40 days, you're going to be overthrown. When they heard it, they repented, the whole city. And Jonah was sad about it. Jonah said, I knew it. I knew if I came and I preached that you would have mercy on them. See, he didn't want God to have mercy. He didn't care. Here's what God said to Jonah. He said, don't you care that there's 120,000 people in that city that don't know their right hand from their left? That's what God said to Jonah. Don't you care there's 120,000 people in the city that don't know their right hand from their left? And God said, and also cattle. Which tells you God's heart about animals. God's looking for a people that care about what God cares about. And when they get a glimpse of it in their heart, they say, God, I'll give you my life completely. I'll become one with you so the world will believe. That's why we're called to become His dwelling place. It's not to be selfish about it. Oh, yeah. Or, you know, if it's about us, we can just say, nah, I'm already blessed. My rent's paid. I'm healthy. My car's running okay. And the little bit of the presence of God I feel on Sunday, that's enough for me. Well, if all you care about is you, maybe it is until judgment day comes. But if we care about God, if we care about what God cares about, we give ourselves to Him. And then we tell Him, Lord, make us into one. Make us your holy dwelling place. That's why we've been talking about it. We want to pick up on that again. I'm just going to review this quickly. Exodus 25, verse 8. You don't have to open your Bible if you don't want to. But God said in Exodus 25, verse 8, He said, make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. God always wants to dwell among and in the midst of His people. And then in Exodus 40, as they finished building the sanctuary, the Bible says, whenever they went into the tabernacle of meeting, and when they came near the altar, they washed as the Lord had commanded. Now look at verse 34. Then the cloud covered the tabernacle of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter the tabernacle of meeting because the cloud rested above it. And the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Notice what they called the tabernacle in the Old Testament. They called it the tabernacle of meeting. Because they knew we are supposed to wash before we go in there. Why? Because we're going to meet God. Now in the American tradition, and I'm not scolding anybody, I don't want you to feel like that. We're just identifying things. Things that need to be torn down. Every thought that exalts itself against the knowledge of Christ needs to come down. That's what a stronghold is. They're in us. When they came, they knew the manifest glory of God is going to meet with us. It's called the tabernacle of meeting. So God said, wash before you go in. They washed. They obeyed, they washed, God met them. See the same thing in Solomon's temple, 2 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 11 through 14. It said, all the priests sanctified themselves. Then the musicians and the singers were as one praising the Lord. A sanctifying means that we get the things out of our heart that are contrary to purity, holiness, in love. Honesty. If it's contrary to honesty, humility, purity, love, holiness, cleanness, get it out. That's what it means to sanctify your heart. So when they would sanctify their heart, it said they all sanctified themselves. It said then they praised the Lord as one. Why were they one? Because when you sanctify your heart. When I sanctify my heart, the Holy Spirit fills me. When you sanctify your heart, the Holy Spirit fills you. If my heart is sanctified, I'm not jealous. I'm not trying to push myself up. I'm not trying to elbow my way to be seen or heard. I humbled myself before the Lord and I'm filled with His Spirit. If I humble myself, you humble yourself, we're instantly, without any effort at all, in total unity. So they sanctified, they got in unity. When they began to get in unity and declare, for the Lord is good, for the Lord is good, and His mercy endures forever. It said the cloud of the Lord came and filled the house. For the glory of the Lord was there. And then it goes on, it said the priest could not minister anymore because of the cloud, for the glory filled the house of God. We're told in the book of Hebrews we're under a better covenant with better promises. They could enter into the glory in the old covenant. We have the better blood. They did it, the blood of bulls and goats. We have the blood of the Lamb. They had faulty human high priests. We have a high priest that's perfect, that lives forever, that prays for us. Their sins were temporarily covered. Ours are washed away by the blood of Jesus. Those priests died. Ours lives forever. Say, well, the glory, you mean the manifest glory, is that for us for today? Listen to 2 Thessalonians. First of all, notice this, the sanctification and consecration is part of that. Consecration is surrendering to the Lord. Giving up our will to the Lord. Consecration, sanctification always precede the manifestation of the glory. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13. Paul is writing. He says, we, speaking of him and his team, we are bound to give thanks to God always for you, beloved brethren by the Lord. Beloved by the Lord. Because God, now please hear this, God from the beginning chose you for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit and believing the truth so that you would obtain the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's New Testament. God chose us that we would be sanctified. That means made clean, set apart, touch not what's unclean. Pure in our heart before God. God said, I've chose you to be sanctified by the Holy Spirit and by believing the truth so that you could obtain the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what, there was a glory in the book of Acts church. It's missing today. We need to recover it. God doesn't love the first century more than today. The needs of people are not different than they are then compared to today. In fact, they're greater today probably. There's more people in darkness. More people in bondage. More kids growing up with broken hearts. More broken homes. More addicted people. More people on pornography. More people in homosexuality. More people going down the path of sin. And then ending up with broken hearts. Broken lives. And we, in the flesh, don't have the power. The power is in Christ. The power is when the church is full of the Holy Spirit. It's not in my... I can say the gospel words, but unless I'm full of the Holy Spirit, it doesn't work. I can say it, sing it, do it, but if I'm not full of the Holy Spirit, it doesn't happen. It's not by might or power, it's by my Spirit. The great need of the church is sanctification, a deep heart cleansing. Now, Joshua 3:5, Joshua told the people, sanctify yourself, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders. When will God do wonders? The day after we sanctify ourselves. That's when. It's not a mark on a calendar. It's a place in our heart. We might think, well, I'm already sanctified enough. That's our problem. I'm already living a clean life. That's our problem. We don't understand what sanctification is. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be in blatant sin. It just means you're in neutral. Sanctification is when we intentionally give our affections, give our will, give our mind, give our thoughts to the Lord. It means set apart exclusively for Him. And again, Psalm 24, verse 3 says, who may ascend into the hill of the Lord? The hill of the Lord speaks of His manifested glory. That's where God told Moses, come up on the top of the mountain, I'll meet you up there. Who can ascend up there? Who can stand in His holy place? That's where the glory is. And the answer is found in Psalm 24, verse 4. He that has clean hands and a pure heart, has not lifted up his soul to an idol nor sworn deceitfully. There it is, honesty again. You say, well, that's Old Testament. We're all clean right now by the blood of Jesus. That's not what James said. Of course we are. When we receive Christ, our sins are washed away. But we need to maintain a walk with God every day. Now, James is writing to believers. If you want to, open your Bible with me. We're going to look at James chapter 4. He's writing to believers. And we can all go deeper in our sanctification. And when we do, the presence of God will increase in our life. And you were made for the presence of God. You are, whether you know it or not, you're like a fish out of water until you get full of the Holy Spirit. Nothing else will scratch your itch. Nothing else will do it. You were created by God for God. God's plan for you is that you would give yourself completely to Him, allow His Word to sanctify you, and that He would fill you to overflowing of the Holy Spirit. And that you would have a deep, deep satisfaction of His presence filling you. And have a deep satisfaction of you becoming a vessel that He uses to bless humanity. And knowing all the time that it's not you, that you're a vessel, that is Christ in you. We're created to be vessels of God, filled with God. We're created to be lovers, helpers, lifters, givers, prayer warriors. We're created for. Jesus said in Luke 4:18, He went to the temple, they handed Him the scroll. He opened it up to the place where it was written of Him. And He began to quote from Isaiah. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to heal broken hearts, to open prison doors, to give sight to the blind." That means the Holy Spirit comes on the church not so we can feel good, but so we can help people. But if we don't care enough about our city, and I'm not saying that you don't, I'm trying to awaken that in us. I believe you do care, you wouldn't be here. But if we didn't care enough, and we gradually, imperceptibly, without realizing it, allow the cares of life to overtake us, then we get to a place where we're just thinking about me, my bills, my health, my career, my life, my family. Those are all incidental. Jesus said, "Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and He'll add to you everything else." So the reason why we want to be filled with the Holy Spirit is so that we can be vessels to heal broken hearts, to open blind eyes, to set captives free. And God will use all of us in an infinitely different ways, creative ways, where the Holy Spirit will fill us and use us in the workplace, at school, at home, by our neighbors. But He wants to build His people together into a holy dwelling place where the glory of God manifests. James says in James chapter 4, verse 8, "Draw near to God, He will draw near to you." That's it. If we would believe that, we would start behaving different. Draw near to God, He'll draw near to you. I believe everybody here wants more of God. Amen. Don't you? I mean, want more of God. God says, here's how to do it. Draw near. That's a promise. God said, if you'll draw near Me, I will draw near you. All right, Lord, how do I do it? He says, Cleanse your hands. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament, mourn, and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Verse 10, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. He will lift you up. There's three main things if we're to draw near. We need to learn how to draw near. One is through the cleansing of our hands. That speaks of all of our deeds. That means be fair, be honest, be upright with our deeds. And then he said, purify your heart. You double-minded. Now the word minded is, the word mind in the Greek is where we, is psyche. Or actually P-S-Y-C-H-O-S, psychos. It's actually our soul. Where we get the word psychology, which means a study of the soul or the mind. The mind is part of the soul. But it really means your heart. The word, Greek word heart, is cardia. It's where we get like cardiac arrest or cardiopulmonary. Heart in this passage means the center of your being, the very core of who you are. Let that become pure by no longer being double. Now the word is mind, but it really means your soul, which is psyche, your mind, will, emotions. It means your affections, your loves, your will, your priorities, your desires. They're double. I love God, but I also want this. I love God, but I also do that. I love God, but this. He said, you double-minded. Your heart is not pure. Become single. Just love God. Let Him add everything else. So he said that if you want to draw near to God, God will draw near to you. He'll draw, again, how He does will be infinitely different maybe for all of us. But I know this corporately, God will draw near. God will come near. Where there's an intentional purposing in the heart to say, God, I purpose in my heart to spend time before You asking You to show me how to have clean hands. My work, my business, my relationships, my speech, everything, I want to have clean deeds. Number two, God, I want to have a pure heart. A pure heart means I love God first. He's my highest love. The number one thing that's burning in me through the day, if I have a pure heart, is as I go through my day, hour by hour, am I in God's will? Am I pleasing God? Am I abiding in Christ? That's the burning motivation of someone who has a pure heart. Is what I'm doing pleasing to God? Is it giving glory to Him? And any time I step out of it, or I slip, or I immediately repent and get back. That's a pure heart. We can have a pure heart no matter what level of maturity we're at. A pure heart doesn't mean you're completely sanctified and made perfect yet. It means you're wholehearted. At whatever level you're at, your wholehearted devotion to the Lord. This is how we draw near the Lord. He said, cleanse your hands and purify your heart. Don't be double-minded. Psalm 86, verse 11 says, teach me your way, O Lord. I will walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear you. The word unite means it's the opposite of a double-minded. It means I have one focus, one goal. He said, the word unite also means to join. In other words, he's saying, God, I don't want to have divided affections. I want to have my heart on You. And also, I want to be joined to You. So he said, unite my heart to what? To fear Your name. It means to walk in such a way. To fear God means I don't want to do anything unless it's pleasing to God. I don't want to say anything unless it's pleasing. I don't want to do any business unless it's honest. I don't want to talk with people unless I'm telling the truth and I'm speaking grace and love. I don't want to be part of gossip or backbiting or murmuring. I want my heart to fear the Lord. That's what it means. That's what's a united heart. Now, if you will, turn to 1 Peter chapter 1. We're looking at how to have clean hands and pure heart. And I know you're going to pursue this. I am too. And what's going to happen is, week by week, month by month, the presence of God is going to increase. At some point, His glory will break in. And when that happens, it won't be any different than the Old Testament. No one will be able to minister. When the glory of God comes in, the pastor doesn't preach. It's an offense to God. When God's glory is there, you shut up and worship Him. When God's glory is there, everybody gets out of their chair and gets prostrate on the ground. Not because anybody said to do it, because in your heart you want to. That's what's missing in the church. It's our inheritance. Romans tells us we are joint heirs of God. We inherit Him. When God comes in the house, the city will gather at the door. Mark 1:33. 1 Peter chapter 1. I'm so thankful that we have Scripture, aren't you? Verse 22. He said, since you have purified your souls, that's the same word as double-minded. It means die, psychos. It means your soul is double. He said, you've purified it, your soul, in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren. So what brings purity to our soul? Sincere love. It means I'm honest with you. Kind. Gracious. There's a sincere caring. Right? There's a purification happens to our soul as we grow in love. Things that are contrary to the love of God is what defiles us. One of those things is bitterness. It says the root of bitterness defiles. Unforgiveness. Selfish ambition. These are defiling. But sincere, genuine love purifies our soul. When love comes out of our soul, it purifies us. Okay? So we should pursue that. Now he goes on. And he says, seeing that you have purified your soul in obeying the truth through the Spirit, in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart. Pure cardia. Heart. So when he said, cleanse your hands, purify your heart, the way our heart becomes purified is by loving people sincerely from the heart. Okay? Now, let's break this down a little bit. When he says, you have obeyed the truth through the Spirit and sincere love of the brethren, the word love he uses there is a different word than he uses later. The word love he uses is Philadelphia. It means brotherly love. Now that's a good thing. It means there's a genuine care for our brothers and sisters. There's an affection, a holy affection, a caring, a sincere love. He said, you've done that. And it's purified your souls because you have that love, that Philadelphia love. He said, seeing that you've done that, love one another fervently. And when he says love fervently, he used agapeo. That's the agape love of God. That's beyond Philadelphia love. Philadelphia love is, you're my buddy. You're my friend. You're in my home group. You're in our home group at church, or I sit by you at church. We have brotherly love, and that's good. He said, seeing that you've done that, it's purified your heart. You sincerely do love. He said, now go farther. He said, go to agapeo. He said, You've purified your soul. You have Philadelphia love. Now, agapeo each other. That's the love of Christ. And your heart, cardia, will be pure. So the love of Christ is a disinterested love. See, when I love my body, it's like Jesus said, when you invite your friends, don't invite your friends to a meal because they'll invite you back. He said, invite the poor, the lame, and the blind. Inviting you to my house is Philadelphia love. Because you're my brother. I love you, you love me, we're buds. He said, that's good. You should do that. Because that gives you a pure heart. Sincerely love the brother. He said, now go farther. He said, that purifies your soul, but your heart, he said, now agapeo. Jesus said, now, he said, I'm going to tell you who to invite. Invite the lame. Invite people with B.O. That's what happens when we do the food outreach. Not everybody, but somebody. Invite the mentally retarded. Invite the poor. They can't pay you back. That means now you've moved from brotherly love into agape love. There's nothing you can get out of it except the joy of knowing that you're pleasing God. And the joy of knowing that whatever we do to the least of His brethren, we have done to Him. And the joy of knowing that on that day, Jesus will say, when I was hungry, you fed me. That's agape love. And he said, when you move into that, your cardia, your heart is pure. Who can ascend into the hill of God? He that has clean hands and a pure heart. A pure heart means I love people whether they love me back or not. I love people even if they talk about me behind my back. I love people even if they've hurt me. I'm going to love people even if they never apologize to me. I love people if they disrespect me. I love people if they talk down to me. Because we have the love of Christ. We have the ability supernaturally, if we choose. We have the ability, if we choose, to lean on Christ in us, to walk in agapeo, agape love. That means to love with no rewards. That's called being a son or a daughter of the King. So having clean hands and pure hearts has to do with our relationships. As the prophetic word came out at the end of worship, the hidden things in our heart, the little offense. Now listen, getting offended is a sign. Anytime we get offended, that should be a red flag to us. I'm not walking in love. Anytime I get offended, it's a sign to me, Joe, you're not walking in love. You're being self-centered. You're making it about you. It's not about you. It's about Jesus. It's about His kingdom. It's about loving His people. It's about His will. It's not about me. So every time I get offended, I said, thank you, Lord. You just showed me another area of my heart. I need to repent and grow in love. Well, they didn't acknowledge me. Thank you, Lord. You just showed me another place that my ego needs to be crucified. They didn't recognize my gifting. Thank you, Lord, showing me again how big my ego is. It needs to go to the cross. Why? Because those are the things that prevent me from loving. They get my eyes back on me. Poor me. Woe is me. Look how I was treated. Look how I was mistreated. And if we allow those thoughts, then we develop attitudes towards certain people. And not only toward the certain people that we feel mistreated us, but anybody else that comes along that reminds us of them. You meet a new person and they remind you of that other person. And you know, now you don't like them. Oh, I know I hit home now. Listen, God wants to go after every cavern, every little pocket in our heart, every little thing where there's any dishonesty, where there's attitudes, where there's offense. Let's get rid of it. It's not worth forfeiting the presence of God. It's not worth it. We need to love on a deeper level. What does that love look like? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 through 3. It's what Paul said in chapter 2. He said, you're going to be built together into a dwelling place of God. He said, therefore, in chapter 4, walk worthy of this calling. Here's Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. This is, if we want to qualify as a habitation of God, here's how we must walk. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness. Lowliness. The Bible says in Proverbs that contention comes by pride. So when there's contention between a couple of people, I guarantee there's pride involved. And if one person is always blaming the other person, that's more proof of more pride. Where there's contention, it comes from pride. So he said, lowliness, gentleness. This is something the Lord's helping me with. I didn't start out gentle, did you? Man, I'm not blaming anybody. I take a responsibility for my own failures. Man, I grew up in a home. I had a great dad. I could go on and on about the virtues of my dad. Hardworking, honest, generous to a fault, fair, but gentle wasn't in the mix. He was a contractor. You know, the way contractors think. We're going to get the job done. If a hammer isn't going to do it, get a sledgehammer. If a sledgehammer doesn't do it, get a jackhammer. That's how contractors think. Well, that's how my dad thought. If a jackhammer doesn't do it, get a bulldozer. We're going to get it done. You know, I grew up with that. No gentleness. You know how contractors talk? Like sailors. Kind of. My dad wasn't foul. He didn't say he wasn't sexually foul, but blunt and, you know, where the hell is the shovel? You know, excuse me, but that's how he talked. He didn't have a gentle way of saying things. Everything was black and white, right or wrong, in or out. So that's the environment I grew up in, and that was very normal to me, very comfortable. I mean, my dad cleared his throat and we moved. He never told us anything twice. You know, that's a great virtue. I thank God for that. You know, you should never tell your kids, I told you, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do that. And they don't obey. Until your eyes are bugging out, your face is red, your jugular veins pounding, and you're ready to choke them, then they obey. And the reason why is because you didn't back up your word the first time. What you do is you say, don't do it, and when they do it, they get a painful consequence. The first time, when you're not angry, you're peaceful, and they get pain on the backside. And then the next time, you just look at them and raise your eyebrow, and they obey. And that's how kids are supposed to be raised. That's how I was raised. I'm telling you the truth. My dad would clear his throat and we all came to attention. If America had more dads like that, our prisons wouldn't be so full. I don't know how I got on that. Gentleness. What I mean is... I didn't have an example for gentleness. We, you know, I just learned how to say, hey, this is the way it is, you know? And I realized this is not very gentle. We need to learn how to become gentle. So my dad had a lot of good virtues, but that's not an area, was not a strong point. I'm learning how to be gentle. Gentle. Jesus is gentle. He's got all authority, all power, but he's gentle, he's patient. That's how we need to be if we're going to have the unity of the Holy Spirit. Humble, lowliness, Ephesians 4, gentle, long-suffering, that means really, really patient, bearing with each other in love, and the whole goal is to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. To do that, we need to allow the Lord to search our hearts. We can't have offense between us. We can't have strife. We can't have attitudes. We can't have unforgiveness. We need to get it out. We need to purify our hearts. We need to go to another level of the love of God. We can't be offended. Come on. We need to get started. Now, we all may get offended for a moment, but we need to be people that get over it real quick. And the way we get over offense is, for me, when I find something's offending me, I need to grow in love. It means I need to grow in forgiveness, grow in understanding, grow in patience, and get my eyes off myself. Because the offense comes when I'm thinking all about me. Okay? Clean hands, pure hearts is how we draw near to the Lord. Now, we talked last week, and I'm not going to go into all that in detail. We don't have time. We might in the future. But the sanctification process happens by the power of the Word. John 17:17, Jesus said, Father, sanctify them by the truth. Your Word is truth. So the more you read the Bible and the more you meditate on Scripture, the more accelerated your sanctification will be. Okay? Ephesians 5:25 and 26, Christ gave himself for the church so that he might wash her with water by the word and sanctify her so he could present her to himself, listen to this word, glorious. The Lord wants a glorious church, a church that's actually living in obedience to his words. So we have to embrace his word. That's why I'm going to mention this again. I'll put in another ad for the seven commandments concerning relationships. These are right from the lips of Jesus in the scripture. They're on the back table. If you don't have a copy, get a copy, study them, meditate on them, and practice it in our relationships. If somebody bugs you, go to them privately in gentleness, in humility, with the goal of hearing their heart and winning them. To make, not go to someone else. Don't go home and have a pity party and then call your friend and say, you know what happened? What you're doing is sowing division. So anyway, that's how we're going to grow in clean hands and a pure heart. It's through the sanctification, the washing process of water by the Word. So I want to encourage everyone. I mentioned the scripture meditation cards. If you don't have those, get a copy of them. And I want to exhort us to make intentional time a number of times during the week where we'll take the scriptures and we'll allow the scripture to wash us. And I'm just going to take a few minutes, maybe five, and just touch 1, 2, 3, 4 on these points. Why have the card humility? Scripture on humility. Get scriptures on humility because If we want more grace from God, God gives it to us when we humble ourselves. So we need help. So we take the scriptures on humility. We lay down or we get in a quiet place, and we read them, and then we pray and we say, God, let this word happen to me. Here's what 1 Corinthians 15:10 says. I am what I am by the grace of God. Peter and James both say, God resists the proud, gives grace to the humble. Now, if you'll experience more grace if you intentionally get alone with the Lord, intentionally do this, get before God, undistracted, and say, God, I just want to tell you, I am nothing without you. That's John 15. Jesus said, apart from me, you can tell him, Lord, this is what it means to humble yourself. Lord, I can't do anything without you. I tell the Lord that every day because I need to hear it. I tell him before I come out here, I say every time, I said, Lord, I can't preach your word unless you anoint me. Lord, I can't do anything good, Lord, unless your grace comes. Lord, I need your grace. Lord, if you don't anoint me, the word will be dry and dull and no one will get fed. Lord, anoint me, Lord. Lord, I can't do anything without you. It's called humbling yourself. And God gives grace to the humble. I'll say, Lord, help me to love my wife better. Help me, Lord. I can do nothing without you. God gives grace to the humble. Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. So we have to take the scripture and let the scripture get in our heart and humble ourselves. So if you do that, you practice this, the anointing will increase in your life. The presence of God will increase in your life. If you'll always tell the Lord, Lord, I'm nothing without you. Lord, I can do nothing. Lord, I can't even pray without you. I can't even focus my mind. I can do nothing without you. God says, I'll give you more grace. Second thing is a pure heart. We talked about that. I have scriptures on that. Blessed are the pure in heart. They shall see God. So we should take the scripture and say, Lord, give me a pure heart. Let the scripture wash us. You'll start to see the Lord. I'm not boasting in anything except in the grace of God. But I've seen the Lord a number of times. He's come to me a number of times in dreams. I've seen him once when I'm wide awake. But everybody can see the Lord. It's not less real when he comes to you in a dream. He came to Solomon in a dream. He said, ask me, do you think it's less real? It's not. It's in the spirit realm. I've seen the Lord a number of times in a dream. He's come to me and talked to me. We can see the Lord. Blessed are the pure in heart. They shall see God. Humble, you'll get grace. Then it said, if you have grace on your lips, Proverbs 22:11, the king will be your friend. So we should meditate on scripture so that our tongue doesn't gossip, murmur, complain, or backbite. Or repeat anything that we shouldn't repeat. We shouldn't just repeat some things. But it says, if we have grace on our lips, Proverbs 22:11, the king will be our friend. And then, of course, love is the other card. If we abide in love, we abide in God, and God abides in us. So if we take these scriptures and practice them, let them wash us, and say, Lord, give me clean hands, give me a pure heart. I guarantee what's going to happen. What that's called is drawing near to the Lord. The Lord will draw near to you. Okay, I want to close with Hebrews chapter 11. If you'll turn with me to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 5. How many want to know the secret of Enoch? It's in the Bible. The secret of Enoch. How many want to know his secret, how he walked with God? It's right here in the Word. And then we'll close with this. I think we were going to close about 15 minutes ago, but I forgot. I started to, but you got me distracted. It's not my fault. I just thank God for the Word. I love the Word. Don't you love the Word? What would we do without the Bible? I'll tell you what, we'd be lost. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 5. By faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death. And he was not found because God had taken him. For before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God. Now he's going to tell us how he pleased God. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Now, there's two things that he mentioned. It didn't say if you have faith, you can please God more. No, you can't please God. I can't please God at all without faith. I don't care what we do. It doesn't please him unless it's in faith. Without faith, you can't please him. We need to understand that. You can't. I don't care what you try. You can't please him. It's impossible. Why am I saying that? He then says two things we need. We need to believe that God is, and that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek you. Now, we all believe that he is. There's no credit in that. The Bible says the demons believe. And they tremble. So let's get rid of that one, because we all have that. We all believe he is, right? That only leaves the other one. We must believe that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. That means of those who diligently draw near, he rewards. That's the secret of Enoch. He, listen to me please, Enoch pleased God. It said he had the testimony that he pleased God. How? He believed that God would reward him if he sought him. And most of us in American church don't believe that very much. Please, I'm not trying to put anybody down. I'm not saying you don't have faith. What I'm saying is that the level, the degree that we seek the Lord is exactly proportionate to the degree that we believe he'll reward us. The reason believers in the Old Testament, this is my closing case here. The Old Testament believers, the reason they saw the glory because they believed. They called it the tabernacle of meeting. Meaning, we're going to meet God. They said, well, God commanded wash, we're going to wash. They washed up. Then why are you washing? God's going to come in his glory. Amen. And when they went, God came in his glory. Today, now that's changing here. You're believing. You're sanctifying yourself. Now let me speak in generalities of the American church. Today, many don't expect anything at church. If anything, they might expect what they had last week. A few songs, a little bit of the presence of God, hear the preacher, pat on the head, go home. Don't expect nothing, don't get nothing. Without faith, please hear this, it's impossible to please him. We must believe that he is. We must believe that he'll reward those that seek him. Now, if we believe God, God's word, he said, if you'll draw near me, I'll draw near you. I don't care what your condition is. I don't care how far away you think you are from God. I don't care how sick your body is, how poor your bank account is, how sin bogged down you are in sin. If you'll start drawing near God, he will draw near you. Doesn't matter how far away you feel. If you'll make a step, he'll make a step. You'll sanctify. If you'll cleanse your hands and your heart, he'll come near. Now, that lays it squarely on us. We are no longer waiting for God to show up in Lancaster. We're no longer waiting for that. He's waiting for us to cleanse our hands and purify our hearts. Because He told us that's the way we draw near. And if we say to ourselves, I've already got clean hands and pure hearts, we are so deluded that we need more help. They might be cleaner than they were last year, but they're not clean enough. Because if they were, you'd already be going with the glory all over you. There's room for all of us to keep going. It's quiet in here. I'm glad we took the offering already. You know I'm just kidding. I don't mean it. I pray that somehow God would jolt us and make us realize, do I believe or not? If I believe, draw near to God, He'll draw near to me. If I believe, I'll do it. If I don't believe, you know what the Bible calls it? It calls it an evil heart of unbelief. See, the way to please God is different than we thought. The way to please God is with faith. Now, when it says Enoch was translated by faith, it didn't mean he said, okay, Lord, I'm ready to go. By faith, I'm going to go. That doesn't mean that at all. That's nonsense. It means he believed God would reward him. So he sought the Lord. So he diligently sought Him and he kept seeking Him. And every time he would seek God, God would meet him more. He said, maybe it started with a prophetic dream and he saw the Lord in a dream. And he got hungry. He said, ooh, that was awesome. I want to seek Him more. So he kept seeking Him more and God would reveal Himself a little more. Oh, today I felt more of His presence, more peace. I'm going to seek Him more. And he kept seeking God, kept seeking God, kept seeking God. And every time he drew... And I mean, seek God, draw near. Cleanse your hands, purify your heart. That's how you draw near. Cleanse your hands, purify your heart. So every time he did that, he started getting more. And he kept doing it until he was no more. Until he was gone. God took him. God said, you sought me so much, I can't give you any more down earth. Come up here. So let's be aware of our faith level. Let's be aware. Let's make a choice and say, I believe that if I draw near, He's going to draw near. If I'll cleanse my hands and my heart, if during this week, during next week, during this month, I get before the Lord and I say, Lord, I want every unclean attitude out of my heart. I want my deeds clean. I want my lips clean. I want my hands clean. Cleanse me. I want to love you first. I want to be totally yours. If we start doing that, the day will come in here. The day will come in here. You'll lift your head off the floor and you'll ask each other, what day is it? Because the glory of God is in our midst. And when you are able to get up, you'll notice your body's completely healed. And your heart's full of joy. And your hands are burning with the fire anointing. And you can't wait to go out and talk to somebody about Jesus. Amen. Let's become His dwelling place. Let's break out of the unbelief habits and patterns of coming to church, not expecting to meet God. Not, and because we're not expecting, not preparing.